Good morning. Oh, it's not that cold out. Before we get started, what prayers do you bring today? Jason? Say that one again. Barb, thank you. Aubrey? Archie? And Mike and Brenda? Linda Jean? Joe? Any other prayers for today? Reverend Kay, yeah. And Keith. See, once you open the floodgates, there's always more to pray for. Okay, we will hold these people and situations in our prayers today, and I will carry them with me through the week. The teachings of Christ are a light at our feet and a guide on our path. We light this candle today to symbolize the word that burns within us. May we be inspired by our experience together here today. Amen. And now I invite you to rise in body or in spirit as we sing our gathering music, God Lights a Lamp. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Please be seated. As we acknowledge the place today, we are reminded that around the world and across the centuries, abuse of power has led to division and suffering. We know that here we live in the midst of treaties of peace and friendship with the Wolastoqe people. May we strive to hold up these treaties and work together for reconciliation and for a better tomorrow. Now, announcements and celebrations. Let's start with celebrations. I heard somebody had a birthday yesterday. Yeah. Yes, happy birthday to Lori. Ah, happy birthday, Lori. Any other birthdays? Anniversaries? What was that one? No? I guess it's just Lori celebrating today, so happy birthday, Lori. Can we sing her happy birthday? Wonderful. Tomorrow looks like it's going to be the day for Bible studies. I was handed an announcement just before we started. There's going to be a Bible study tomorrow, February 5th at 10 a.m. at St. Teresa's Roman Catholic Church Hall. This is sponsored by the Fredericton Women's Interchurch Council in preparation for the World Day of Prayer. The speaker then will be Barry Miller, and refreshments will follow. So I encourage you to go to that at 10 a.m. tomorrow, and then at 6 p.m. tomorrow, Join us on Zoom for our last Bible study session for the next couple of weeks. We're going to be gathering at 6 p.m. on Zoom to read about the Transfiguration. So I encourage you, if you haven't joined us, join us tomorrow. It's a great opportunity, and then there's no responsibility after that to join again. Our next Bible study won't be until the start of the Easter season, and then we'll run from then until Pentecost. So I encourage you, if you're able, to make it out tomorrow. Speaking of Transfiguration, that is coming up next Sunday. We're going to be sharing the sacrament of communion as we prepare to begin our Lenten journey together. So communion next week. Also coming up before Lent, we're going to be having our pancake supper on Shrove Tuesday. That's February 13th. It's $10 for adults and $5 for kids under 12. Let's see. I've got a couple others here. You may have seen in the announcements that went out this week that we are seeking a finance committee chairperson. So there is some information in there about the responsibilities. Two meetings a month, finance committee and council, facilitating conversation at the meetings, and working closely with our treasurer, Bonnie. So if you're interested in that, or if you know someone who might be, or if you have some questions, reach out to me, please. We're hoping to get that position filled by February 25th, which is our annual meeting day. Yay! Who doesn't love annual meetings, right? For the region, I'm on the annual meeting planning committee. That's how much I love annual meetings. So that's all I have for announcements. Are there any others? Okay, then I'm going to invite the birthday girl for another announcement.
Morning, everyone. We have youth group tonight. We're decorating Valentine cookies, so come in and decorate, and then you get to eat them, so there you go. Anybody that wants to join us. And also the other thing is our ukulele workshop is next Saturday. And so if you have one that's not being used, we are in need of some more ukuleles. We'll keep searching for them. We'll check the libraries and see what we have besides the 10 that we have. So I think we're up to probably 15 or 16 people. And we are the music next week at for Ministry of Music. So we'll be practicing our ukulele overnight, see if we get ready for Sunday morning. But anyway, we're looking forward to that. So if you do have access to a ukulele, let us know and you just drop it in at the office and then we can have them ready for Saturday. Thank you.
Any other announcements for the good of the community or for the glory of God? No? Then I invite you to join with me responsively as we call one another into this time of worship. We come seeking the wisdom that Christ brings. We come to feel his power wash over us. We come to be transformed by Christ. Child, a sibling, a healer, a teacher. Let us pray. Holy One, you are our teacher in this life. And so we come before you this day to learn and to find ways to grow closer to one another and to you. Sometimes your word can be hard for us to hear. Remind us that at the core of your word is love. Sometimes we aren't sure of the person who brings your word to us. Open our hearts to know the difference between your truth and the world's distractions, no matter whose mouth you speak through. Most of all, we pray that our very souls are a place where your word can call home, where your word is received with open arms, just as we are received by you. This we pray in the strong name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Now I invite you to rise in body or in spirit as we join our voices in singing, I am the light of the world. Voices United, 87. I invite you to remain standing as together we proclaim our faith as described in a new creed. Let's offer it together. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. As we let the words of that statement of faith take root in our hearts, let us listen as the choir offers their gift.
Thank you. I get some young and young at heart come up to help me? Oof. How's it going? Good? How you doing? You're cold? Aw. Better?
Get off me, Dad.
Okay. That's fine. How are you guys doing this morning, other than cold? Yeah? Has anybody ever asked you to do a favor for them? Yeah. Yeah, I do it all the time.
Yes.
All the time, right? Maybe take the dishes out, do the dishes, do the laundry, some things like that, right, from time to time, right? Has anybody ever asked you to keep a secret? Yeah? Well, I'm not asking you to tell me. You can keep the secret. That's fine. Now, okay, so favors and secrets, fine. Now, has anybody ever said to you, I have to tell you a secret or I have to ask you a favor, but before I tell you, before I ask you, you have to promise you'll do it and you'll keep that secret? Anybody ever done that? Yeah. Really? What do you say to that? Like if somebody says, I want you to do something for me. I can't tell you what it is until you promise you're going to do it. No, you got to promise to do it first. Well, I guess I can't ask you. What about you? If I ask you, I want you to do me a favor, but you have to promise you'll do it before I ask you. Has anybody ever asked you to do that? Yeah? What have you done? You asked them? Well, I don't know that I could do it yet, right?
Yeah, I don't know if it's doing something bad.
Maybe it's doing something bad, right? Mm-hmm. That's something that kind of happens in our scripture reading today, where a king promises his daughter, he says, I'll give you whatever you want, up to half my kingdom. And he says this in front of a lot of people, so it's not like he can say he didn't. And then she asks him for something not so good. In fact, it hurts someone. Okay? That's not good, is it? What should the king do in that situation? When she comes up and she says, I want you to hurt that guy. He promised her whatever she wanted, up to half the kingdom. What should he do? He shouldn't do it, right? But won't he be embarrassed because he promised her? Doesn't really matter, right? We have to be really careful with our words, because our words, our promises, they mean a lot to people. They mean a lot to the people with whom we share our lives, right? Like if we promise that we're going to do something for somebody, we better hope that it's something good, right? Right? Like it's easy to say, I promise that I'll be there to help you, right? Whenever things go really hard. Right? Or I promise that I'm always going to be able to be there to support you, right? But we always have to be very careful. If somebody comes up to us and says, I need you to do me a favor, but I can't tell you what it is until you say you'll do it.
See you.
Right? We have to be careful about that. We have to be very careful about our words and how we live into it, right? And if we do say, oh, of course, I love you, Amy, of course, whatever you ask of me, I'll do it. And then you kill somebody. No, I'm going to say no to that. I love you, my child, but no, right? We have to be bigger than that. And the promises that we make, if they hurt someone else, that's not a promise worth keeping, right? What do you think? Yeah. So you think that we can walk this world being careful with the promises that we make and trying to live into the ones that heal and help people? Think we can do that? Try and avoid the ones that hurt people, right? Let's pray together before we go off to Sunday school, okay? Dear God, help us, your children, to be mindful of our words and the ways that they can help and the ways that they can hurt. Help us to keep your word at the center of our hearts. Amen. Thanks for your help, guys. I hope it's warmer downstairs.
It's probably colder.
I find it really warm in here, but that's just me. I'm crazy. Well, as we let the wisdom of children find root in our hearts, let us pray together as we seek wisdom in our holy scriptures. I invite you to pray this prayer of illumination with me. God of light, you have revealed your very self to us in your Son, Jesus Christ, your Word made flesh, who lived among us full of grace and truth. Open to us to your revelation once again, that in the words of your holy scriptures, we might know your presence and follow in your way. Amen. And now I'm going to invite Bob Bartlett forward to offer our scripture readings.
Glad when you said to me,
"Let us go to the house of God."
And now our feet are standing within your gates, O Jerusalem.
Jerusalem is built as a city bound firmly together.
There the tribes go up, the tribes of God, to give thanks to the name of God, as we decreed for Israel.
There the thrones of justice stand, the thrones of David's house.
May the peace of Jerusalem, may those who love you be prosper.
May there be peace within your walls, prosperity within your palaces.
For the sake of my kin and friends, I say, peace be with you.
For the sake of the house of our God, I seek your good.
Gospel reading is found in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 6, reading from verse 1 to 29. He left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James, Joseph, and Judas, and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house." And he could not do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no food, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, "Whenever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and refuse to hear you as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. King Herod heard of it, for Jesus' name had become known. Some were saying, John the Baptist has been raised from the dead. And for this reason, these powers are at work in him. But others said, it is Elijah. And others said, he is a prophet, like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard it, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has been raised. For Herod himself had sent men who arrested John, bound him, and put him in prison on account of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because Herod had married her. For John had been telling Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted to kill him. But she could not, for Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man. And he protected him. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he liked to listen to him. But an opportunity came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his courtiers and officers and the leaders of Galilee. When his daughter Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his guests. And the king said to the girl, ask me whatever you wish, and I will give it. And he solemnly swore to her, whatever you ask me, I will give you, even half of my kingdom. She went out and said to her mother, what shall I ask for? She replied, the head of John the Baptist. Immediately she rushed back to the king and requested, I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter. The king was deeply grieved, yet out of regard for his oath and for the guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately the king sent a soldier of the guard with orders to bring John's head. He went and beheaded him in the prison, brought his head on a platter, and gave it to the girl. Then the girl gave it to her mother. When his disciples heard about it, they came out and took his body and laid it in a tomb. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A hard word to hear today indeed, as we reflect on what we have heard. Let us join our voices as we sing together, Let My Spirit Always Sing. That's More Voices 83. What's the tune we're doing? It's a different tune. You'll recognize the tune anyway. Let's sing.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Let us pray. Speak into this time, O God. We have heard your word and ask now that you unfold it for us. Reveal your truths and guide us to a faith-filled action as your children, as kindred in Christ. Speak, O God, and may your word find a home in our hearts this day. We ask this and all things in the name of the living word, Jesus Christ. Amen. The word is a powerful thing. It brings life in the beginning. It brings new life when we think that the end has come. We never know how we're going to respond when we hear it, how we're going to react to the word breaking into our lives. We hope to respond with open arms, embracing the word as though it were coming home. Our reading today is actually filled with lots of different ways that the word might be received. There's people who embrace it, people who don't even recognize it, people who are afraid to hear it, and people who try to silence it. But part of figuring out what the word is saying to us is finding ourselves in the reading. So who are you in this reading today? Are you Jesus mourning the lack of faith in his hometown? Are you the blessed few who find healing because of your deep faith in this Messiah? Are you one of the disciples going out two by two to share a word that has taken root in your heart? Are you John the Baptist, persecuted and punished for speaking truth to power? Are you Herod, the power, trapped by your choices, forced into making another terrible choice? Are you Herodias, asking for the head of the one who you feel has wronged you? Or are you Nazareth, the hometown of the upstart Jesus, unwilling to accepting the word from a carpenter's son? The truth is that until we know who we are in the midst of the word, we cannot find our path leading from it. And who we are in a particular reading changes each time that we approach it, and even if we approach these readings without faith at our core, you and I, we have a place in this scripture passage where the Messiah is rejected and the prophet is beheaded. So who are you today when the word comes knocking? As much as we'd like, we can't all be those few whose faith led to wholeness, those few who are healed. And while we are sometimes the ones being rejected and persecuted, we can just as easily slip into the role of rejecting and persecuting. We're the Nazarenes who can't get past our expectations around who can and who can't bring the word. We're Herod, digging a hole deeper rather than admitting that maybe we were wrong for the choices we've made. We're Herodias, seeking to silence the truth because it makes us uncomfortable or casts us in an unfortunate light. These are the broken parts to play in this reading for sure, but just as important as knowing who we are in the midst of our holy stories is finding out how we grow from them. Just a little background on the parts of Herod and Herodias. You see, Herod had previously been married to a woman by the name of Phasaelus. He divorced her, and Herodias divorced her husband Philip, Herod's brother. Now, this might all seem like things that can happen without batting an eye today, but in those days, in the days of John the Baptist, it was a bit of a scandal, and he was not quiet about it. Because of John's vocal opposition to the marriage, Herod had him imprisoned, and we know Herodias eventually sought his death. So if we are Herodias in this passage, where is our light? Where can we grow in response to the word? Well, whether or not she saw it in the moment, she knew that John was right, at least according to the laws and the practices of the day. How many times in our lives have we heard that voice inside us that shows us the right way to go, but we ignore it, silence it even, because it's not in our own self-interest. It might be in our best interest, but it's not what we want right now. Like John, that still small voice within us is persistent, but unlike John, it's not so easily quieted. And while acknowledging our own brokenness is difficult, we are called to walk that road back. We are called to find redemption in the truth, to allow the voice to speak, not so that it can tear us down, but that it might build us up and show us the way forward. So if you are Herodias sometimes, uncomfortable with hard truths, there is light for you here. Herod is in a similar boat to Herodias, but there's another piece that the story offers to try and give him hope. Herod imprisoned John because of what he was saying, yes, but he did not immediately have John put to death because, as Mark writes, when he heard him, he was perplexed, yet he liked to listen to him. Herod didn't like what John was saying any more than Herodias. But when John spoke, even if Herod didn't understand, he liked to listen. There was something in what John was saying that spoke to Herod on a level that he didn't understand. But it spoke to him in such a way that it stayed the executioner's hand for a while. So yes, we are Herod in those times where we treat the word like a form of entertainment, something that we take out from time to time to listen to because we like the sound of it, even if we don't really understand it, even if we don't really hear the word. We hear it, but we don't allow ourselves to be transformed by it. But Herod was caught in a deeper trap when he foolishly promised his daughter anything that she would ask for, up to half his kingdom, a promise that he made in a very public way. When the request came for John's head, he had two choices. Be publicly embarrassed by breaking that promise, that oath, something that was unheard of in those days, or follow through, no matter the consequences. We're Herod because we too make stupid decisions all the time in our lives. We do. And like Herod, just as often we are offered paths back from those choices, but we're stubborn. And when we start down a path, even when we are given ample opportunity to come back, we continue down that road so that we don't look foolish for the choice that we made, even if it is to our own detriment. Well, I made this choice, I'm going to stick to it no matter what. The word, the living word, is not just a show that we watch or listen to once a week. It is a map to reconciliation and wholeness. Sure, we might have to eat crow on the way, but someone is less likely to lose their head on the way to truth when we allow ourselves to admit when we're wrong. So if we are Herod from time to time, there is light for us. Light on the paths that are revealed even when we make the wrong choices. So that leaves us with Jesus' hometown of Nazareth. But of all the parts that we could play in this reading, this one might be the most familiar and the most relatable, right? Most people know the saying, you can't go home again. That saying means that things change. We change. The people that we knew and the places that we grew up change. But perceptions, they rarely change. We have an image of what home is like. And our home and the people who are still there, they have an image in their mind of who we are. When both of those are confronted with one another, it's hard to reconcile what was with what has come to pass. In the case of Jesus, he went to his hometown of Nazareth to heal, to share the word with his family and friends. But the people could not get past who he had been so that they could see who he had become. And as we read in last week's scriptures, where the woman was healed by just touching Jesus's robe, faith in the one who is sent is just as important as the power of the one who does the teaching and the healing. They didn't believe in him. They saw him as a carpenter's son. And so when he went to this town, this place where he grew up, to heal and to teach, he couldn't do what he was doing everywhere else because they didn't have faith in him. We say often in this place that we want to make a home for Christ, for the word in our hearts. But how often is that home more like a hometown? We welcome the word in, but we don't take it seriously. We don't take what it has to say very seriously. We do that because for many of us, we've heard these stories so many times before. We think we know what they mean, what they're trying to say to us, and we don't think that there's anything new to hear. But we must open ourselves to meet the word anew, to acknowledge that since we last met, us and the word, we have changed. That the word, the living word, has changed with us, calling us in new ways. Who we are when we're reading these holy scriptures, the parts that we're playing in them, these are important things for us to know, and they change every time that we approach the word. Sometimes when we read this story, we might be the Nazarene. Sometimes when we read it, we might be those whose faith healed them. But as I said at the beginning, the word is powerful. It can bring about transformative change in us. And so who we are when we come to the word is different when we leave it. How we respond to the word, how we grow from who we are in this present moment to who we will be in the next is just as important. Are we going to keep being like Nazareth, like Herod, like Herodias, rejecting the word because it's easier to find an excuse than it is to follow it? Or are we going to open ourselves up to the word, be vulnerable to it, and allow it to be a part of becoming, of who we are becoming? I invite us to go from this time with the courage to speak truth into hard situations, like John. I invite us to go with the strength to support one another in building a better day today and tomorrow in an effort to repair some of the choices that we made in the yesterdays of our lives. I invite us to respond to the word with action, striving not just to be people who sit together once a week, who sing together once a week, but people who grow together in faith every day, so that we can create in ourselves a home where the word flourishes. Let us pray. We long, O shepherding spirit, to follow the word, to let it be our guide and inspire us along the way. Open our ears that we may hear what Christ is trying to share with us. Open our hearts in those times when we must hear hard truths. work and walk through us as we strive to transform our lives and our world to reflect the kingdom. This we ask in the strong name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And now let us rise in body or in spirit once again as we join our voices in singing, Let There Be Light. Voices United 679. Please be seated. And once again, I'm going to invite Bob forward to offer our mission and service story.
I was very moved when I read this story, and I think the scriptures today come very close. So keep that in mind as you hear this story on the lessons of racism learned when young. The following is an excerpt from a blog written by Adele Halliday. Your mission and service gifts support anti-racism programs and initiatives like the one Halliday developed in the United Church Anti-Racism and Equity Leading to help all of us into a deeper, more equitable relationship with one another. The name calling started when she was about 3 years old. They were racial slurs and names and taunts. My child, my own flesh and blood, was being ostracized for having black skin. The people slinging the insults, other children on the playground. She may not have necessarily always understood the particular terms that were used, but she knew that they were related to her blackness and her racial identity. This deeply wounded her tender heart. Despite all of our intentional modeling, teaching, and proactive actions, our child is still already developing internalized racism and inferior notions of herself. The children who taunted her were offering explicit and overt notions of racism, but they were children. They had not even started primary school, and yet, the children had learned behavior at home or elsewhere in society that whiteness is superior. And they had the audacity to vocalize that in an innocent little child. This is a part why I'm so deeply committed to dismantling racism in all forms. Racism is damaging and destructive for all people in society. It reinforces negative notions for people of color. I live it in a peculiar way because of my racial identity. As a black person who has lived with racial injustice my entire life. The systematic nature of racism is something that cannot be ignored. This effort to overcome racism is a continuous effort, and I am committed to this work for the long haul. And I hope that you will be also, because I know I am.
Thank you very much, Bob. A harsh reminder, especially as we begin Black History Month just a few days ago, that racism still has firm roots in even here in Canadian society, and we must strive daily to find ways for wholeness together. And this is just one of the many stories from our mission and service stories of the work that's being done to try and dismantle racism in the systems that we live and work in. And now, as we seek God's blessing on all that we bring, I invite you to join as we sing together, Grateful. And I think we'll sing it twice. Let's dedicate this offering together. You come into our lives and make a home in our hearts, O Christ. We respond by giving of our time, talents, and treasures. We ask that you bless all that has been given here today and through par and through our service to you. May we continue to follow in your way to bring light and hope to all. It is in your name we pray. Amen. Now let us breathe deep of the Holy Spirit that has drawn us to this place, a spirit that continues to point out to us what is wrong in this world. Let us pray. Hear us, O God, as we come before you in this moment. Hear our prayers, hear our concerns, hear our thanks. And then speak to us the needs of this world. We begin with thanks, because while there is much that weighs on our hearts this day and brings us worry, there is just as much and so much more that gives us joy. We give thanks for one another. You have gifted us with companions on this journey through life in the forms of friends, family, and strangers, all of whom are a part of who we are and will become. We give thanks for this day and all those that came before it. Some were darker than others, and for some of us that darkness persists. But what is stronger than any darkness is the light of your love shining in our lives. We give thanks also for the word that you have given to us, a word from which springs your love life. It meets us in unexpected ways and transforms us. For all these things and so much more, we give you thanks, O God. Even as we remember all those blessings in our lives, we also come before you with prayers of worry and concern. This world seems on the brink of shattering. And so we pray for your healing. We pray for your guidance. And we know that not everyone is ready to hear you. We pray for those places that are torn apart by conflict. We ask that you send your spirit into those leaders to work towards peace, to find a way to friendship. We pray especially for those who have lost loved ones in these conflicts. Reach through us, that we might embrace those who have lost and let them know that they are not alone. We pray for our kindred in this world, both near and far, who are walking difficult roads and in need of your strength. Work in and through us as we strive to support one another on this journey. We pray for this community of faith. Help us always to hear your word and to eagerly respond with action, to give of ourselves in service, not to and for ourselves, but in service to you and for those in need of a place to call home. Especially today, we pray for those people and situations that hold a special place in our hearts. Pray today for Mike and Brenda. We pray for Linda Jean and for Reverend Kay. We pray, O God, for Jason. And we pray for Barb. We pray today for Keith. And we pray, O God, for Joe. We pray for Aubrey, and we pray for Archie. As we look out on this world, we pray, O God, for peace. Peace in the midst of conflict, peace in the midst of terror and fear. Peace in the midst of a world that seems to be tearing itself apart. We also pray for our kindred in Nova Scotia and Newfoundland as they wrestle with weather. Keep them safe. Keep them warm. We pray today for Norma Crandlemere. We pray for her and we pray for her family who is around her this day. Continue to embrace them through this difficult time. Lastly, we open our hearts to offer up those prayers which are too deep for words. Hear them, O God, in the silence of this moment. These are the prayers of your people, prayers that we bring together and lift to you in the prayer that Christ taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I'm glad I didn't look up at the picture that was there for the prayer. It was a cat in the snow with its eyes just above the snow. I would have lost it. I don't know how you kept it all together. Anyway, let's join our voices as we sing together our closing hymn, "Will You Come and Follow Me?" Voices United, 567. Please join me responsively as we send one another into this week with trust, with faith, with hope. Go now with the love of God in your hearts, the peace of Christ in your hands, and with the power of the Holy Spirit at your backs, to share the good news you've heard this day. Amen. And now let's sing our choral closing, "I Am Walking a Path of Faith."
Thank you.